You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Oh, hi. My name is Don Gauthier. This is SMT 312 Natural Disasters. I'd like to welcome you to our last broadcast in this particular semester. I want to, again, welcome you and remind you that whether you're a student in the class or not, you can always join in our discussions. And today should be interesting as well, because we're going to be talking something that is a little bit contentious out there. So here's our phone number, 800-339-1193. That's the way to get a hold of us directly. And we can put you on the air and we can discuss anything that you have on your mind. This is our email address. If you want to send us an email, we can kind of transliterate it for you. We can present it, your question here, and then we can discuss that as well. It's another way of doing it. And there is our Twitter page, and so you can tweet us at DHTV Live. And yes, we are live today, and we are eager to hear from you. So all that being said, our topic today is, of course, climate change. And that's the topic that, of course, raises lots of eyebrows and a whole lot of contention in the world out there. And some of it has to do with basic misunderstandings of the science and also a kind of frustration with the lack of progress we've been making in order to kind of curtail the impacts of global climate change. So we begin today with just a short presentation that looks at how people around the world are looking at this issue. And it's very different from what you might expect. Here in the United States, we have somehow politicize this entire issue so that it's very difficult for us to really think clearly about what the issues are and what the policy objectives should be and how we should approach this whole question of climate change. We also understand that climate change is not a process that has equal impacts everywhere. And so some nations will benefit, some nations will not. Some parts of the country will see negative impacts, others will see more positive impacts. So it's all very complicated and complex. And we'll talk about that complexity as well in the coming hour. So in this particular last program, Lecture 13, we're going to be looking at this issue, and we want to make sure that you're well informed and as up to date as possible in this. And just to show you how this class somehow mirrors reality, or reality mirrors this class, yesterday was the last day of the Doha Climate Conference, and we'll return to this a little bit later on, because this is again a kind of follow-on to the earlier Kyoto Protocol, which the U.S. never signed, and we've never kind of agreed that we would limit our emissions. And there's another story just out in the news as well, from came out last week, very quietly. No one, you know, even picked this up, mostly in the press, that the oil sands in Canada, which are, you know, being shipped mostly to the United States, that we extract the oil from this, from these oil sands in Alberta, Canada, actually are increasing the emissions in Canada. Their overall target is now being diminished by this. So it's almost as if we take one step forward and then we take two steps back, because Canada was making lots of progress in terms of emissions because they were turning more and more to hydrologic power and things like this. So you can see that there are complicated issues here and lots of different stakeholders that are negotiating out here about what they want to do about climate change. So in our first video segment, which I'm going to show you right now, it's called Climate Voices. And really, it's different people from around the world talking about the impact of climate change, their concerns about it. And you'll find that, again, they're very different opinions than what we hold here in the United States.
When we talk about climate change is a global issue.
It's the same in climate.
Les changements climatiques ont changé ma vie.
Quand on se trouve dans une situation invivable, on va migrer.
Man würde mit schweren Herzen die Halle verlassen.
So you must stay.
I think one of the most difficult challenges ahead is for us to prepare ourselves to deal with the large-scale human movements that will inevitably occur as a result of climate change. And I go back to my experience growing up at a time when I was living in Texas and there was massive drought, and my friends, many of whom were workers on the farms and ranches where I lived, had to leave because the ranches and the farms were no longer viable. These were many people, there many of these people didn't have the resources to make that move. They lived on the edge every day of limitations in food and finances and work, and it was extremely difficult. We're going to see enormous problems dealing with human migrations that will occur with climate change.
Sabula mado ka fo jigo fle ka ta chugo mi feni nan toro chugo la amna ka chugo ka chugo mi net neto do donc mir la la ka fo un na mo nyako jigo na toni chugo na ana toni gela en kon nana a abi jiga ngono ka fo ko ame yoro re bla ka yoro re nyini mi mi sekap sa am.
Well, there's talk about moving it across the harbor or further south from here, but that's a big job. You got to leave that to our children and their children. We can't expect the community to just all of a sudden abandon what's already there and try and find someplace else. It'd be better for them to try and like basically what Tuck did is in order for us not to relocate, there was big contracts put out to bring Boulder from Inuvik to help the erosion on the peninsula.
When the first discussions on climate change came in our country, there was a group of people that said, well, maybe we have to move to Germany, to higher areas. I was not part of that group. I'd much rather pick up the challenge to survive here and reinforce the dikes and make floating houses and stay here. We want to stay here, and it has become government policy. We are here to stay, even if the sea level would rise 1 meter or 2 meter. If it's beyond, the challenge may become impossible. But we can look in our history. Always people in the Netherlands have wanted to stay where they live.
I'm very scared about the future of the Maldives because I myself, I don't want to be a climate refugee and I don't want to move to another country because of climate change and because of problems like sea level rise. So I always have the fear in my heart that someday we might have to leave our beautiful country because of climate change and move to somewhere else.
Eto amader dhaka arsi apnar ei bonnar karone bonnay to amader sob niye geche tai amra thakbo kotha kishi khamar to hoyte ache na tai amra ki khabo ar ki khaye o jaygay bash korbo tai amader to der chhaira chhara amader ar upay nai diner din bonna hoyte ache tai amra je bari ghar kore thakmu kar jaygay thakmu amra আমাদের তো জায়গা নাই, স্বপ্ন দিতে ভাঙ্গে নিয়ে গেছে, তাহলে আমার অন্য জায়গায় কি আমার থাকতে স্থান দিব না, তাহলে তো আমার ঢাকা ছাড়া আমাদের উপায় নাই।
People are migrating, they used to migrate 12 times in their lifetime on average, and today I see them migrating every year, sometimes 20 times, sometimes 25 times, that means in their lifetime. And each migration is related directly to poverty. They lose their homes, they lose their lands. From a rich man, you become someone, a beggar on the streets. And this is heartbreaking because people lose their dignity, they lose their will to live. And you create these huge population of climatic refugees, which people are not even aware of because they are remote. They're in remote areas.
For 1 meter sea level rise, about 35 million people of Bangladesh coastal area will be displaced. Now they'll have to go somewhere. Where will they go? Well, the obvious rational place is those who created the problem of climate change, that is the rich Western countries who are enjoying the fruits of development which is displacing these people. It is those countries they have to give the location and accommodation to these people in the near future. I have been in the United States and I've talked to many people, the State Department and many scientists, that you know Bangladeshis would need a part of Maryland, a part of Florida, a part of Texas, because these are the few countries, including Europe and Japan and others, those who have been responsible for the climate change in the first place.
As a Maldives low-lying country, should not take the risk, but we should go for other contingency plans like adaptations and also migration. For the migration, well, international laws has to be changed. It has to be changed, and the climate refugees has to be accommodated, like the political refugees, because the fear of persecution, you know, we have the fear of sinking here.
So actually, there's about 7 billion of us now on the planet, and the kind of need to address climate change, and especially these low-lying areas where sea level is actually beginning to take place, sea level rise is beginning to take place. You can hear in people's voices that the concern about this. And again, climate migration has already happened. Remember the largest North American environmental disaster, the Dust Bowl in the 1930s. Saw an out-migration from those areas of nearly 6 million people, people going back east, people heading north, people heading out to California, one of the, you know, the major destinations and a very major part of our California history. And so these types of movements, large-scale movements of people, are not unseen or not unheard of, and we've had these before. There's also the issue that was mentioned by the gentleman from Texas who spoke first, this idea of inequity or inequality in terms of wealth, and how difficult it is for people that are poor who are already living on the edge, whether it's because of the environment or because they're just simply poor, they have very few options. And so the only thing they can do is leave where they are to go somewhere else. And that's where you make that gamble, right? The big gamble in life is to migrate. And the United States has to develop clear guidelines in terms of, you know, immigration as well. And we have to kind of say what it is that we actually want to do and what kind of plan we're going to have for addressing these issues, because we are a target destination for a lot of folks from around the world. And I think there have to be rational programs to kind of accommodate people that are going to come here in the future, and let's make them legal, let's get them documented, and let's move forward as a country, because this is also the way that the world is moving. So we'll talk more about these issues as well. Now, some of my students are concerned about, you know, their extra credit and, you know, about the final exam. And so before I go further, I can, you know, kind of address these things. I want to say that I will accept extra credit up until next Saturday night at 11:59 p.m. That's the last. I tried to get it in earlier. If you can get it in earlier, I'd appreciate it, just so, because I have to turn in grades fairly shortly after that. Robert wants to know what sort of areas I plan to emphasize on the final. Well, there's the areas that we have not really been tested on yet. That's the last couple of chapters in particular. And then there are some general questions from earlier on. The exam will have some true-false, multiple-choice, objective-style questions, short answers, and things like this. And I will also have two essays that are, again, no more than a page apiece, you know, 250 words or less, addressing larger issues. You know, the point of the final essays is to kind of get you to think about the course as a whole and some of the larger issues that are a part of this course. And those were introduced very early on in the class, and they're addressed in the first chapter of the book and the introduction, the kinds of things like linkages between and different types of events, the kind of mitigation measures, you know, how do we make people aware of this this dangerous earth that we live on, all those kinds of topics. So keep those in mind. There is, I agree, a tremendous amount of material to cover. Again, use your quizzes as a guide to the kinds of things that I feel are important that you should know. You should also, you know, read the chapter summaries at the end. That'll help you. But, you know, that's all I can tell you, really. I mean, I hope that that helps. But I think most of you are doing fine, and you don't really, you know, need to worry too much about that. As far as the extra credit papers, yeah, they should just be submitted by email to my dgsmt312@gmail.com. Okay, that's my, and that'll come to me, and I'll get them there. Robert says, what climate migration suggests is that wars may be inevitable. What is your take on this? Well, I certainly hope that we can address this without having wars with people. I know that there is going to be pressure on nations who are already poor themselves to accept other people. And of course, even within the countries where they are located now, for example, Bangladesh, it's one of the lowest lying countries and one that has been most impacted by disasters ever since it was formed, you know, separated off from India with Pakistan back in you know, the 1940s, late in 1948, I guess. You have this country that is densely populated. There's very fertile soils there, and a lot of, you know, positive aspects of that environment. But there are recurring floods because of the monsoon rains. There are typhoons and cyclones that come in and, you know, devastate the area. And so there's not many places for those people to move unless they end up, you know, moving, you know, out into an adjacent country. And there are issues with that as well. You know, a Muslim country moving into Hindu India, you know, these kinds of things are going to be demanding of our ability to solve problems, and we need to be aware of these things. So in terms of whether they're inevitable or not, I must say I certainly hope they're not inevitable. I might say that it's possible that some of these conflicts could lead to warfare, but I hope that people have the sense to realize that this is, you know, we're all in the same boat. I mean, there are people here on our East Coast that are going to need to relocate out of their, you know, homes that are alongside the Atlantic Ocean now that we've had Hurricane Sandy to remind us that these are not safe. And as sea level rises in general, and we're seeing this already, we're going to have also more frequent storms, that these are not the wise places that we need to, that we should be living in. So so I would just want to remind you that there's a difference between climate and weather. When we talk about climate change, we're talking about a kind of long-term processes, and weather is day-to-day, but climate is over long periods of time, months, years, you know, millennia. And we need to make sure that we understand the difference, because when we talk about weather events, like Hurricane Sandy, for example, we can talk about it in the context of climate change only in the sense that it is a possible manifestation of warming of the atmosphere, more energy in the kind of terrestrial and atmospheric environments, and how this has an impact on us, on people. And of course, the more people there are, the more likely these disasters can turn into catastrophes. And that's one of the big points that this book has made throughout, you know, that there's this kind of line, and you cross over from a disaster, which is relatively, you know, unexpected event with lots of consequences, to one that is catastrophic in that it affects many more people, larger areas, and of course have more devastating consequences as a result. When we talk about climate as well, we have to realize we're talking about climate at different scales. Geographers use this term to refer to kind of levels of analysis, but we can talk about scales by giving examples. For example, in our backyard or in our patio, or even if we don't have you know, much in the way of a garden, we can have a patio plant or something that grows out there. Around that plant, there is a kind of microclimate. That particular balcony faces the sun or faces away from the sun, gets more or less light, it gets rainfall when it falls, or it's completely protected and enclosed. And there are kind of makes for what we call a microclimate. These are just small areas, some corner of your backyard where, you know, other things can't grow. I have a place where cactus does very well, but if I move it to another part, it just dies. It's, you know, it's too close to the shore, it gets too much rainfall. Then we have local climates, which are slightly larger in scale. They are something like 24 of these in Southern California that the Sunset Gardening book recommends, or, you know, recognizes, I should say. And they're kind of larger in scale. And then we have regional, like Southern California. We can talk about that as kind of a region. And then we have global, and that's, you know, made up of all of those other kind of scales. They kind of all combine to make up the global. But the global is the hardest for us to grasp as well, because it's very difficult for us to think about the Earth as a, you know, complete sphere. And we still have, in many senses, you know, 13th, 15th century views of the world, in the sense that we see what's in front of us, and we rarely think about, you know, the entire planet as one connected, interacting system. And that is, of course, something that takes practice and a little bit of attention to. And when we talk about climate regions, and I think we have a graphic here, a gentleman named Vladimir Köppen came up with a map that he used to map the world's climates. And he also, in the bottom here, you can see these are different cities, different locations all along here. And they all represent different climate types. And then they're referred up here to the map. So this color here, let's see if we can find one that's it's easy to see. This color here, desert climate, very low rainfall. That's what those little dotted lines along the bottom are. And here we have the desert climate here. And the city is, I guess, Khartoum. And sorry for the lack of clarity in the lettering, but it's all there. So you can see, though, this is how he did it. And he used two variables. He used average monthly temperature and average monthly precipitation, as well as kind of visible clues in the landscape for things, you know, that he couldn't experience directly or where there was no meteorological evidence. He used visible clues as well. But those putting together this kind of climatic map in 1914 or so, he gave climate scientists a way of looking at the global environment using these kinds of climate regions. And so we have everything from tropical rainforests, you know, shown here in the purple, and they kind of end up kind of in the equatorial areas, to, you know, kind of what we call the southeast subtropical areas up here in China, and then the southern and southeastern United States, and even parts of Australia, all located on the southeast parts of continents. So there are certain configurations of, you know, temperature and precipitation that give us the clues about climate, in particular climate regions. And so we still use this today. Some are modified, kind of minor modifications made to this to adjust for other changes. But in general, this is something that we still use as kind of a framework for looking at climate. And then we also have to, we talked about spatial scales, but now we also have to talk about some of the temporal scales related to time. We have what we call past climates, the paleoclimatology, or old climate, the study of old climates, what took place thousands of years ago, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of years ago. And then we have present climate, study of, you know, what's going on in the world today. And then we have future climate, which is a predictive kind of climate. We talk about what can happen given, you know, these types of, you know, changes. And we see this as well in what we call global climate modeling, which we'll get to in just a bit. So spatial scales, temporal scales, and when we have a more complete view of climate, and it helps us to kind of understand what's taking place, past, present, and future, and wherever we are on Earth, and whatever scale we want to look at it at. And of course, there's another part of the world that we haven't really talked about. We talked about the kind of four basic spheres of the world, but there's a part of the hydrosphere that is most important, especially as we discuss global warming, and that is the cryosphere. The cryosphere is the frozen world, the world of ice. And while the amount of ice at any time on the Earth, you know, varies, we do have Again, along those same scales, in the past we had major glaciations covering most of the northern hemisphere, down to the present where we have retreating glaciers and melting of, you know, polar ice and things like this. So the cryosphere actually goes through a lot of change in just normal circumstances. And whether we don't view it as a very hospitable kind of environment, and yet many species do make are successful in surviving their polar bear's den on the ice and the sea ice in the Arctic. It may not be hospitable for us, but it is for other species. And of course, evidence for past glaciations, looking at just how things have been changed and modified over long periods of time. We have here a view of the last glacial maximum. This is when the continental glaciers covered most of the northern hemisphere down into the United States, around, you know, past Wisconsin, and all the way across Asia. This is 18,000 years ago. And of course, the gradual warming that took place after that event allowed for the blooming of what we call civilization, you know, the rise of city-states and the Fertile Crescent and that region and the first settlements and agriculture and all those kinds of things that have been a hallmark of civilization around the world. And of course, there's other aspects of this glaciation that we haven't really dealt with a lot, and we'll get into this a little bit later too. And that has to do with the more ice that's kind of on the land, the less ocean water there is, and therefore sea levels actually drop during these periods of maximum glaciation. So at one point in time, in the last glacial period, for example, we had a lot more land available to us because, you know, this kind of freezing of the cryosphere actually extracted moisture. And you see the beginnings of agriculture here, and you know, these are along the bottom of thousands of years ago, so we're about maybe 13,000 years ago, we saw the beginnings of agriculture. Then we move into the what we call the present interglacial period, and where we expected a drop-off here, our normal trend would have gone that way. Instead, we have what we call the super interglacial, where we have carbon dioxide being added to our environment. And a lot of this coincides with the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution, the transformation of our economies through the use of coal, and later on other fossil fuels like petroleum. And what this meant to that environment is that, you know, we created the conditions that led to further warming. And so you see a kind of peak on that diagram there. So, I can never get this right, over there, okay. So. Let's talk about the evidence for past climate change, because one of the arguments that we have with folks is about how do we know what we know, and is it, you know, sufficient for us to draw conclusions about what took place in the past and what might be possible here in the future. So again, we use instruments wherever possible, but before 1860 we had really no accurate instruments for measuring temperature, even simple things like temperature. We have historical writings that contained information about what was taking place at a particular time, or notes that monks and abbeys and places like this noticed about, you know, when the cherry trees blossomed, or when the first, you know, birds arrived. And, you know, that we have this in Southern California, you know, the swallows returning to Capistrano. It's always been around or about St. Joseph's Day, which is in March 19th, they would show up. But we've seen them sometimes arriving earlier, and we're kind of, you know, making note of that as well. Also, a person that we'll mention in the next hour towards the end, Aldo Leopold, was very interested in this kind of aspect of, you know, climate and the kind of keeping a record of when species begin to arrive, when they begin to, you know, do what they do in their environment, whenever they arrive. Whether it's breeding or reproducing, or actually just hanging out, you know, using it as a refuge for a while on their way to somewhere else, you could keep track of these comings and goings, and it gave us a sense of what was taking place in the natural world, and that's really important too. And then we have what we call paleoproxies. thing, a proxy is something that's, you know, stands for someone else. So if you have a proxy vote for your stocks or, you know, whatever, essentially you're giving someone else the authority to vote in your stead at a, you know, a shareholders meeting in a particular way, and they record your vote and then they represent it as coming from you, but you're not physically present. And so paleo proxies are very interesting because they allow us to use other evidence, evidence that at first seems, you know, pretty, well, maybe we're stretching this, but when you look at it closely, you begin to see how it all fits together. And you realize that on the Earth itself, there are records that are being kept on a daily basis. We just don't always see them that way. You look at a tree and, you know, you say it's a tree, it has lumber, you know, you have habitat, you know, there's birds and insects that are living in the tree and all that, but you hardly ever think of what takes place in the course of a year on a tree where it adds actual mass to itself as it grows. So another growth ring every year is added to the accumulated growth rings, and they're marked or stored as a record in that tree at that location for as long as that tree lives. And afterwards, it's still useful because we can use that as a record to help us go back further in time. We'll talk about dendrochronology in just a second. But this is what we call proxy data evidence. And it is very, very important because it allows us to substitute other things for having a thermometer or having a rain gauge in our hand or things like that. So we use what's available in the natural environment. And there are many things, it turns out, that are that grow and develop this way that allow us to look back and look back further and further in time. Plus, there's also the other types of technologies now that come about as with the discovery of radioactivity and the transformation of elements through time, the radioactive decay of certain isotopes and unstable elements into others, that we have now an understanding that this is done in a fairly regular manner. So we have a decay of elements at a kind of steady state. You know, we continue to decrease at a regular rate over time, and that allows us to calculate back as well. It's very, very interesting and very cool stuff, and I still remember my my first class in all of this archaeological and radioactive dating back at UCLA, and I'm Dr. Berger was a very interesting man who had traveled all over the world and had gathered all kinds of evidence for change and how they measured it, and I was still fascinated by this. Anyway, our really first and best example of this, at least, you know, for us in Southern California, is this idea of dendrochronology, which is measuring using trees, and tree ring dating is another way of looking at this. And this diagram behind me shows you the different ways that we can use pieces of wood that come from the same forest, essentially in the same location. We look for a pattern in the rings. So this tree here, for example, has this pattern, and we can follow it in this piece of wood that's over here in the dead tree, and then it's incorporated into the wood of an adobe here, but the same pattern shows up, and we can go backward in time as a result, so where they line up. And this allows us to go back over a long period of time as we pull more and more pieces of wood together, because wood is a good sink for carbon, and carbon-14 is a type of dating process that allows us to look back in time, not quite to 50,000 years, but, you know, we can go back pretty far and at least far enough to get to the human side of things, you know, where we emerged. And of course, we use other techniques, potassium argon, the radioactive decay of uranium into lead. These give us longer scales to look back in time to determine ages of things by how much remains. So we talk about the half-life of carbon. It's 5,000-something years. We can then look at the next half-life, and we know that much time has gone by, and that gets us back pretty far and pretty comfortably back, at least to 26,000 years or so. And we can go a little further if we have the right amount of carbon material left. But there's a change from this kind of carbon 12 and 13 and 14. These kinds of elements become changed over time. Carbon 12 becomes, you know, is more or less stable and decays. But we have this transformation that takes place within the carbon isotopes, and the unstable carbon 14 gives us that a kind of clock that allows us to look back in time. So I have a short video that looks at this issue, and then we'll come back and talk more about other proxy evidence.
I call him Lord of the Rings.
The Tree Ring Lab is hands-on, and so we encourage everybody to touch these pieces of wood. This is a cross-section of a redwood tree.
David Staley is a dendrochronologist at the University of Arkansas.
The annual growth rings in trees are a natural archive of environmental history. The time series history of fat rings and skinny rings is telling you about the history of wet years and dry years. So this is a piece of African bloodwood. This was found in western Zimbabwe.
Long before high-tech weather instruments, nature has kept precise records of rain, drought, even fires.
The climate history encoded in the annual rings of trees is unique. It's like fingerprinting.
With support from the National Science Foundation, Staley is helping Mexico prepare for future droughts by looking at how trees responded to severe drought in the past. That will help fine-tune predictions about how future dry spells will impact the ecosystem and could help the country prepare for future water and energy needs.
One notion is that this 21st century drought may be being aggravated by human activity, both at the global scale and at the regional scale due to land surface changes.
Deciphering tree rings can also help historians solve mysteries, like the fate of the New World's lost colony of Roanoke. Could drought have been a factor?
This is a piece of bald cypress from Blackwater River, Virginia. That is the most severe drought of 800 years in this part of the United States. And that's a significant year because of the disappearance of Virginia Dare and the other colonists at the Roanoke colony in North Carolina. This is a Swedish increment borer, and with this tool we can extract a core sample without seriously harming the tree.
In the field, Staley and his team target old growth forests with the least imprint of human activity.
Oh man, these are stupendous trees. They're so precious.
And that's a ringing endorsement from this Lord of the Rings. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
So there you have a kind of brief overview of dendrochronology, a relatively new and emerging field, and one that really took off here in California, up in the White Mountains, where we have discovered some of the oldest trees, in fact, the oldest living trees, the bristlecone pine. And there's the whole story about a gentleman named Douglas and how he kind of discovered this fact. You know, that we cut down a tree, we counted the number of rings, and there are over 5,800 and some years of tree history right there in front of them, and it's kind of amazing because these trees looked hardly alive. They're living way up high in the mountains at a very high altitude where it's cold and dry, and yet these trees have managed to survive. The question is, for the future, with climate change, will these trees still survive into the future, and will warming bring in new competition and eventually drive them to extinction as well, which is another aspect of climate change we'll talk about as well. Ocean and lake sediments are another place we find these kind of proxy records, because sediments are laid down in layers over time, and this the material that gets laid down is often not only rock and mud and sand and those kinds of mineral materials and things, but we do get also plant material and evidence of other creatures. And here we have some views of radiolaria. Radiolaria are plankton that develop their own unique exoskeletons, and they incorporate within their shell structures not only a particular form, but they also have particular mineral constituents, and we can tell a lot if we find a lot of a particular variety of radiolaria about the chemistry of the ocean where it was found, for example, and in the temperature and all kinds of other information just from these tiny, and these are microscopic views, by the way, of radiolaria. They're very, very tiny, and one of the best jobs you can get in graduate school as a paleoclimatologist is to sort lots and lots of these in bins and little trays with a magnifying glass, or a microscope, I should say. I'm just kidding. Anyway, lake sediments work the same way. And we do have evidence, for example, in Morro Bay for the arrival of the Spanish and the transformation of the local pollen. Suddenly new types of pollen show up in the estuary there at Morro Bay. And they can be measured down, and we can measure where there were fires and where the creek didn't flow as high, and where there was, there's all this information just in these sediments, layer after layer. We do also have the evidence that's been found in ice cores, and much has been made of these ice cores because they take us back so far. We've been able to go back over 200,000 years in some cases at the South Pole close to South Pole near the Russian station at Vostok. They've been drilling, and they have almost a 2 mile thick core of ice that takes them back a very, very long time in Earth history. And so we're going to look at ice cores. We also have a number of ice cores from Greenland and other areas. So let's watch this short video.
Far in the north of Greenland, a team of climate scientists from 14 nations, including the U.S., has just completed its first season of drilling a 1.6-mile core of solid ice.
What you see here is a piece of ice from the climate change between the last glacial and the present climate. It's about 11,000 years old, and it contains a lot of tiny little bubbles of the ancient atmosphere.
J.P. Stephenson is the field operations manager for the North Greenland Eemian Ice Drilling Project, or NEEM, the project's ultimate goal: to unlock the climate history trapped inside those tiny bubbles.
The beautiful thing about an ice core is that it's got all of these different indicators: atmospheric composition, temperature, mean ocean temperature, dust. All these kinds of indicators are on exactly the same time scale.
Jeff Severinghouse, a scientist at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, is working with NEEM scientists to reconstruct all those indicators in the hope of learning more about a period in climate history known as the Eemian. The Eemian period started about 130,000 years ago, and we know it lasted about 15,000 years before the Earth plunged back into an ice age.
NEEM is really trying to get a record of the last time that the Earth was warmer than today. So it's an analog for what our future looks like under global warming.
During the Eemian, temperatures were somewhere between 5 and 9 degrees Fahrenheit warmer than today, a scenario that climate models suggest could happen again by the end of the century if present trends continue.
It's a very, very realistic scenario for what we may experience in the next 100 to 200 years.
We're getting older and older. With every meter we're melting, we're getting back to the future.
30 feet below the surface in this huge trench carved from the snow is where this ice core research begins.
The newest thing we have now at NEEM that nobody else has tried is a very sophisticated analytical system. It's called continuous flow analysis, where actually in the field you cut a slab of the ice core, a thin rod of ice following the length of the ice, and you tilt that vertically and you melt it on the hot plate from one end, and then as it melts, you do the analysis, millimeter by millimeter.
You can hear the bubbles coming out of the ice.
The samples are also cut, bagged, and boxed up, and then shipped to research centers around the world.
We call it the post office.
Come on, Tim.
The logistics of ice core drilling are far from simple.
It's just complicated, and I hate complications. I like things to run smoothly.
The operation starts in the small town of Kangerlussuaq on Greenland's west coast.
My first season was in 1980, so that's 29 years ago, and that was a marriage for life.
Keeping the operation running smoothly is his wife and fellow scientist, Dorte Dahl Jensen, NEEM's project leader.
I work mostly as coordinator of the project, kind of to get the drill teams and the scientists and the logistic people and the airplanes to come.
The airplanes come courtesy of the 109th Airlift Wing of the New York Air Force National Guard.
Approach 5.5.
And pilots like George Alston.
Well, we're the only unit in the world that flies the specialized LC-130 aircraft, a C-130 on skis, which allows us to support the scientific efforts and take these large airplanes and land them on skis.
But getting to the ice drilling camp is just part of the challenge.
It's always light, so when you first get here, it may be a little hard to sleep. It takes a couple of nights to get used to it, but then you get so tired from work and from not sleeping the nights before that it no longer becomes a problem.
Vasily Petrenko is a scientist at the University of Colorado.
It's a very simple life. It's kind of like a frontier outpost. We sleep in mostly in those red structures that you see behind me. They're called weather ports.
While the Neem Field Camp may look like a frontier outpost on the surface, Petrenko and others are engaged in very sophisticated scientific research underground.
One of the things that we see in the ice cores is a strong correlation between carbon dioxide levels and temperatures. So at times of warm temperatures, carbon dioxide is high. At times of cold temperatures, carbon dioxide is low, which reinforces what science has been showing recently, that carbon dioxide does cause warming.
And that warming leads to melting. The Greenland ice sheet contains enough ice to raise global sea level by 23 feet, a worst-case scenario associated with global warming. Satellite data from the NASA GRACE mission show that Greenland's reservoir of ice has plummeted in recent years. About 340 billion tons of ice melt in 2007 alone, about the same as San Francisco Bay draining completely every week for a year. Scientists hope this new ice core will tell them how much of Greenland's ice melted during the Eemian period, when global sea level was 13 to 20 feet higher, a finding that could be crucial in determining how much and how quickly sea level could rise over the next several centuries.
We know from all the other ice cores we've drilled that we find...
So, we could go on and on talking about that, but very, very interesting work that they're doing in Greenland and also at the South Pole in Antarctica. There's a number if you have questions or you'd like to add your voice to the discussion, 800-339-1193. And again, whether you're a student or just a member of the community flashing by, looking at football and looking for a break for a little bit, this is a place where you can always express yourself, and we're always welcome to have you. You can contact us also by email, and there's our email contact address, askdhtv@gmail.com, or you can use the Twitter line and tweet us as well at DHTVLive. There you go. So. Let's keep moving on with our discussion. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about pollen, because pollen is what we find in lake sediments and other types of sediments as well, just to show you kind of what pollen looks like under a microscope and the different types. And also, there we have pollen. These are all. This is actually with an electron scanning microscope. And we also have the evidence from coral reefs, because coral reefs are also built up by the of communities of coral reef animals, and they leave behind their exoskeletons. They became part of the reef, and they are in fact the world's largest living organisms, if we consider them as one whole. The Great Barrier Reef of Australia being the largest kind of reef, and they exist within parts of the oceans that have particular temperatures and particular light requirements. So they're good indicators of sea level, time rise, and temperatures as well. So we use those as proxies for that particular purpose. And we already mentioned and talked a little bit about carbon-14, and I don't want to go into that in too much detail, because we're going to run out of time today if we don't quickly move on. I was going to show you a rather large, it's actually kind of a long video here, that talks about climate science and empirical evidence for human-caused global warming. But I don't think we're going to have really a lot of time to get to it. So if we could just show for a few minutes until I give a cut sign, and then we'll kind of move out of it and kind of move into our next part of our lecture, that would be great. So maybe we could take that on now.
Hello, good science, not junk science.
Right.
And I think rather than committing ourselves to huge amounts of money, we ought to know what we're talking about.
Global warming, I think, maybe it was made up by overeager scientists, the same scientists maybe that made up things like evolution and gravity. Cuckoo, right?
In the many responses I get to these videos, it appears that a number of people want to deny or are not even aware that there's a scientific foundation to the overwhelming consensus on climate change.
There is no scientific evidence that CO2 is a pollutant.
Many people want to see the single paper, the single bit of proof, the magic bullet that seals the case for global warming. Of course, that's not how science works. The massive body of evidence for climate change has been built up from global observations over 150 years. One might as well ask, show me a single proof that smoking causes lung disease. In fact, the science is built on thousands of publications and many decades of observation. In this video, we'll go over some of the fundamental discoveries, the basic facts that we know beyond a doubt about global warming. Of course, no amount of proof is sufficient for those that believe climate science is all a global conspiracy.
Some Bolshevik plot!
Damn scientists!
In 1859, the English physicist John Tyndall, using equipment of his own design, showed that certain gases in the atmosphere blocked and absorbed long-wave or heat radiation. 4 decades later, Svante Arrhenius, with thousands of manual calculations, made an estimate of the global warming power of CO2 that was very close to today's best models. In the 1950s, American Charles Keeling began to measure accurately the steady increase of CO2 in the atmosphere. Spectrographic analysis soon showed that the new carbon was, without a doubt, man-made.
The CO2 released by burning fossil fuels like oil, coal, and gas has a different chemical signature than CO2 released by living animals and plants. And the spectrometer shows that the increase in CO2 comes from burning all of those fossil fuels.
A greenhouse gas like CO2 absorbs and re-emits wavelengths of light in the long wave spectrum, the energy of radiant heat. Such a molecule will absorb and emit instantaneously and in any direction. This is the simple, unambiguous physics of the greenhouse effect.
Physics is straightforward. More CO2 has a warming influence. We can't get around that. It's out there. The rising CO2 should cause warming.
The primary greenhouse gases in the atmosphere include the most abundant one, water vapor, as well as carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, and chlorofluorocarbons, as well as a few other more exotic new man-made compounds. And overall, we like greenhouse gases. As radiation from the sun, mostly visible light, comes through the atmosphere and warms the earth, greenhouse gases trap outgoing long-wave radiation and keep the planet 33 degrees centigrade warmer than it would otherwise be. But as we have added more, especially CO2, the additional warmth is becoming a problem. In recent decades, we have much more sophisticated ways to measure the energy that comes into and out of the planet, not just from ground-based instruments, but also advanced satellites. We can measure accurately the incoming radiant energy from the sun, and we know how much energy the Earth is radiating out as heat, and how much of that is absorbed and trapped by greenhouse gases. Measurements of energy in and energy out have been tracked by scientists over recent decades. This study compared satellite measurements of outgoing long-wave radiation over almost 3 decades. After correcting for increased temperatures and humidity, this graph shows the change in outgoing radiation due to greenhouse gases between 1970 and 1997. The wavelengths for greenhouse gases show increased absorption. And the study concluded, our results provide direct experimental evidence for a significant increase in the Earth's greenhouse effect that is consistent with concerns over radiative forcing of climate.
Damn scientists!
Some Bolshevik plot!
If less energy is getting out, more energy must be coming back to warm the planet, and scientists have measured this as well. In this study, data from 3,200 ground stations collected over 25 years showed increased downward long-wave radiation as predicted by atmospheric physics. Scientists have also looked at other potential causes of warming or forcings in the system. Accurate measurements are available of solar irradiance, which has been flat since the 1950s. We've also measured the effects from the ocean, like El Niño, and the influence of volcanic eruptions. When scientists put all these forcings together, they can make an estimate of the effects on climate over time. Using what we know about climate forcings, Scientists have checked to see if they can recreate known temperature conditions of the past. This series of multiple climate model recreations over the last 120 years tracks accurately with the known temperature record over that time, proving that our models are realistic. But more important.
So there you have some of the evidence anyway, and for those of you who are interested, I will post this on our site, our Blackboard site, so that you can actually take a look at it yourself and look at it more more closely and in your time. Margaret writes in and says, my generation was warned about human-induced global warming in the 70s. I find that most of my friends and I are more conscious of how our habits affect the environment and act to reduce our impact more than I think our current disposable U.S. generation doesn't comprehend how drastically things have changed over the past 40 years. And I think you're right there, Margaret. I think that's one of the things that we've not done a very good job on is really to show, you know, change over time. Not only has the local environment gotten better in a lot of ways here in Los Angeles, pollution and other things have been curbed by some of the decisions that we made, the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, the Endangered Species Act, the requirements for environmental impact reports and things like this that come out of NEQA and CEQA. These are all kinds of policy decisions that we took and put in place. We also have the success of dealing with, in the Montreal Protocol, the excess amount of chlorofluorocarbons that were being produced and released. And so we have evidence for this. And now the United States, of course, not a very big player in the international movement, in especially in Doha this time, but also in Kyoto. And of course, you know, that's because some people have made it a political agenda, and that makes it more difficult to deal with the truth too. We get lost in the noise, so to speak. Okay, so I think we should go on break and come back, and we'll continue with the second part of our lecture. And thank you for being here, and kind of we'll see you in about 10 minutes or so. Okay.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
He's going to have to drop it.
Can you blow my whistle, baby?
Hi, Taurus. My name is Geneva Miriam Koulibaly. I am the ASI president and also a senior of the year 2013. So I'm here to talk to you about the iGAZ campaign, which is a challenge for us to raise enough money to be able to donate iPads to the library for the iPad loan program. So how to give? You can pick up one of those postcards in the Associated Students office, in the library, and also in the Office of Alumni Programs. Make sure that you fill out the bag and return it to the Office of Alumni Programs. You can also visit the website online for the Senior Gift Class campaign. If you're gonna pay right now, it's totally fine. You have the option to make a pledge by giving your information, your name, and your email to the Office of Alumni Programs, and from then you have 90 days to be able to pay your $20.32. And don't forget, you get the possibility to own that beautiful t-shirt with the year 2013 in the back. Very important for you to know, whatever amount of money that we're able to raise, our alumni will support us and match every cent. So don't forget, we want to leave our legacy, we want to be remembered, and once a Toro, always a Toro.
November 1st through November 28th, El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, Day of the Dead altars, and the student showcase in studio art. Mexico celebrates a rich tradition of arte popular that reaches more than 2,000 years into the Mesoamerican past. El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, celebrates this enduring tradition through a variety of ceramics, metalwork, paper art, sculpture, and other works of art. A special Day of the Dead altar installation by Dr. Miguel Dominguez, professor of modern languages, will also be on display, as well as a Day of the Dead altar by the prominent Los Angeles artist Edith Abeita and CSUDH alumna artist Victoria Almeida.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory-based and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org, so opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take folktale, or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back. This is SMT Natural Disasters, SMT 312 Natural Disasters. My name is Don Gauthier, and we are in our last hour of our class in this semester, and we're looking at climate change, and we're going to get to some kind of conclusion today. So I hope that you're going to stay with us for the next 50 minutes or so. We have two questions from our students, I think, in the program here. So can you go over the difference in carbon dioxide from plants and burning fossil fuels? And I guess they're both the same kind of question. They both refer to CO2 and how it differs in plants and from burning fossil fuels. There's a couple of different ways to look at this question, and I'm not sure exactly at what point in the video it mentioned the difference, but I do know that, for example, plants generally take in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. They don't release a lot of it until the fall, or when they drop leaves, for example. Deciduous trees will kind of move that CO2 back into the environment. But a lot of it is stored as a sink in wood and other, you know, plant structures until they begin to decay. So as long as a tree is growing and, you know, it'll hold a certain amount of CO2 present, the burning of fossil fuels releases carbon dioxide. We also exhale, as human beings, we exhale carbon dioxide. We take in oxygen and, you know, the other gases, but we exhale the carbon dioxide. And that's what plants depend upon. They use that as a kind of basic ingredient for the photosynthetic process. So the normal patterns of the kind of, I don't know if you remember the diagram that showed carbon dioxide levels increasing has an up and down component to it as it goes upward. And of course, that up and down component reflects seasonal changes, you know, the difference between the springtime when it begins to take in carbon dioxide from the environment and new growth begins, to the time in the fall and into the winter when this material is then, you know, on the forest floor, a lot of it just, you know, dying and decaying. So that releases CO2 back in the environment. We add to that component the burning of fossil fuels, and we see that rise begin to steepen. And so that I think is basically where they were trying to draw that analogy. And I guess that's the best I can explain that at this point. So what are the, so you know how to get a hold of me. There's the 800 number, there's the Ask DHTV at gmail.com. There's the DHTV Live Twitter account. You can send in your questions or phone calls or whatever, okay? So that's how you get a hold of us here. And again, you don't have to be in the class. You can just be just sitting out there in the audience watching. And if you have a question, you're more than, you're encouraged to call in. Don't hesitate. So what are the observed effects of global warming? So we saw some of the evidence for it, but what are the other things we've seen? Well, we've seen decreased Arctic sea ice. So this has been a phenomenon that we've seen in the news reports of the Arctic Ocean in particular losing vast amounts of ice. And we're worried about the disappearance of sea ice there, primarily because our favorite animal of the Arctic, you know, the polar bear, is now without this special area that they use for their dens and for hunting and things like this. So as the seawater ice melts, it does not actually contribute to rising sea levels because it's already been displacing its own volume while it floats there, in the same way that a glass of, you know, ice cubes, you know, filled with iced tea or whatever, as they melt, they don't overflow. They just simply, you know, hold that same level. So we have decreasing Arctic sea life. We have retreating glaciers. This is one of the observed facts. Also something that that Al Gore in the Inconvenient Truth film that he made also drew attention to, that our own Glacier National Park is losing its glaciers. He spent some time talking about Mount Kilimanjaro in the tropics and how its, you know, glaciers were disappearing. And of course that has local impacts as well, because it means less water available to the folks down below that depend upon meltwater from the glaciers. And then of course, and that's happening in the Himalayas as well. And then of course we have melting ice sheets in general. These are on continental size lands like in Antarctica, although the rate in Antarctica is much slower, and we actually are seeing an accumulation of more material in the South Pole. And of course these are preliminary kinds of things, but we are seeing the differences. We have changing climate patterns around the world. We're starting to see storms where we didn't have storms before. In the recent conference at Doha about climate change, the Philippines Prime Minister, I believe, or the Philippine representative to the conference, drew attention to the fact that this late season typhoon that struck the islands killed over 350 people, did lots and lots of damage. These are the kinds of events that folks in the third world and the poorer part of the world are looking at and going, wow, you know, these are real serious consequences. And of course, if we lose melting ice sheets on Greenland, as you heard in one of the videos, they were talking about a sea level rise of 32 feet, because right now that water is not displacing any volume because it's on top of land. And you can actually see the real outline of the continent of Greenland there, with a very large inland area kind of depressed as a result of the weight of ice. So this whole area here represents an area where the volume of ice is so thick and dense that it's actually had an impact on the crust, and it's actually pushed down. And so we expect, if that were to melt, that not only would that crustal rebound push upward and we'd have a freshwater lake there for a while, but over time that would also drain into the oceans, but over a longer period of time. So rising sea levels, wildfires, you know, we've already begun to see the change as we've moved towards warmer climates in some areas, like in the Southwest. The emergence of wildfires is a real phenomenon, something that we have to plan for in not only in kind of natural areas, but also in our urban areas. We've seen fires race through towns in Texas, for example, and take out homes along the way. You know, these are kind of wind-driven fires. As the climate gets drier in some areas, we'll start to see more fires as well. And the links between wildfires and climate change are going to be a little more tenuous, because there's a lot more variables involved, but they're there nonetheless. And of course, we see the changes in the biosphere, changes in where you know, where plants and animals live. We've lost maple syrup production to Quebec because Vermont is warmer and they don't have the kinds of temperatures needed to really get the sap flowing in these sugar maples that are there. And so this is what's going on as well. And of course, the ranges of species, you know, how far north or south are plants liable to move. And here, that's a chart, actually. You really can't see it very well, I'm sorry. So I'm not gonna spend much time on this, but it really does list out, you know, where the migratory species are gonna be influenced, increased temperatures if they're a factor, changes in precipitation, loss of breeding habitat, loss of, you know, non-breeding habitat, you know, the kind of where organisms feed, for example, the loss of migration, loss of stopover sites, you know, when we lose particular ecosystems, we lose areas where plants, animals, insects all need to go. Why are we studying the influence of climate in Mexico, and why are we afraid of drought there? Because that's where our monarch butterflies come from. And for people that don't understand agriculture in the United States, monarch butterflies are the number one pollinators of our corn, of our corn crops. And what is our most important grain? What is the most important thing grown in America? It's corn. Has been for a very long time. Where did it come from? Tropical Mexico. And where do the monarch butterflies live? Up in the mountains of Mexico. So if it gets too dry there, these are friendly immigrants. These are the ones that come across and help us. Huh? Plant migration. Jonathan Sauer at UCLA passed away a few years ago, but I took his course, loved this course. This is dynamics of geographic patterning in seed plant species. You know, in other words, how did things get around the globe? And surprisingly, forests migrate, usually sometimes and sometimes ahead of glaciers. As glaciers move southward, the forests begin to move southward as well, because they have to. And it's pretty amazing, and over long periods of time. So adaptations, extinctions, we're seeing that more and more of our zoos are now being used as really for species preservation more than just for entertainment value. So they have a much more serious mission now in preserving species from going extinct, tigers and other things like this, and smaller species as well. So how do we predict future climate change? What will that look like? I have a video here for you to watch. It's about 3 minutes long, and it'll fill you in on some of the details about how we predict future climate change.
Carbon is the basic building block of life, and these unique atoms are found everywhere on Earth. Carbon makes up the Earth's plants and animals, and carbon is also stored in the ocean, the atmosphere, and the crust of the planet. A carbon atom could spend millions of years moving through the Earth in a complex cycle. Understanding the carbon cycle and how it is changing is key to understanding Earth's changing climate. On land, plants remove carbon from the atmosphere through photosynthesis. Animals eat plants and either breathe out carbon or it moves up the food chain. When plants and animals die and decay, they transfer carbon back to the soil. Moving offshore, the ocean holds huge amounts of carbon, about 50 times the amount we find in the atmosphere.
The ocean is sometimes called a carbon sink, meaning that it absorbs or takes up carbon from the atmosphere. It takes up carbon through physical and biological processes.
At the ocean's surface, carbon dioxide from the atmosphere dissolves into the water. Tiny marine plants called phytoplankton use this carbon dioxide for photosynthesis. Phytoplankton are the base of the marine food web. After animals eat the plants, they breathe out the carbon or pass it up the food chain. Sometimes phytoplankton die, decompose, and are recycled in the surface waters. Phytoplankton can also sink to the ocean floor, carrying carbon as they descend. Over long timescales, this process has made the ocean floor the largest reservoir of carbon on the planet. Most of the ocean's nutrients are in cold, deep water. In a process called upwelling, currents bring nutrients and carbon up to the surface. Carbon can then be released as a gas back into the atmosphere, continuing the carbon cycle. By cycling huge amounts of carbon, the ocean helps regulate climate.
So when you think of climate, you don't often think of the ocean. You know, climate, you think of, is it going to be hotter this year? Is it going to be colder this year? But the oceans are actually a great regulator or controller of the Earth's climate. And they even are controlling how much carbon is in the atmosphere, which can slow down how quickly climate change is occurring.
At the most basic level, the balance between incoming sunlight and outgoing heat determines the Earth's climate. Greenhouse gases act like a blanket and trap heat in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. In the past two centuries, humans have increased atmospheric carbon dioxide by more than 30% by burning fossil fuels and cutting down forests. The Earth has not experienced carbon dioxide levels this high for the past several million years. Researchers are learning that future climate change will depend on carbon levels in the land, in the atmosphere, and in the sea, and how these levels respond to human disturbance. About one-third of all human-generated carbon emissions has dissolved in the ocean. More than 80% of Earth's added heat is now stored in the ocean.
In the future, as the planet gets warmer, the water's going to warm up, and warm water can hold less carbon than cold water. The other thing is, on a warmer planet, some of the currents are going to slow down, and so we might not be forming as much of this cold, deep water. So we won't be able to transport carbon into the deep sea. So on the whole, the ocean's going to become less effective at removing carbon from the atmosphere.
Throughout most of Earth's ocean, the warmer water, weaker circulation, and new temperature gradients that result from climate change will impact marine life and ecosystems. These changes affect the ocean's ability to store carbon. Increased carbon dioxide in the atmosphere impacts marine life in other ways.
As the ocean absorbs more carbon dioxide, it becomes more acidic, and this can be a threat to some of the organisms that live inside the ocean.
As Earth's climate continues to change, how will researchers monitor something as big as the ocean and something as complex as the carbon cycle? NASA Earth Observing Satellites give scientists the big picture view of our home planet. Varied satellites help researchers detect changes in ocean climate and ecology over time, providing vital insight into the health of our home planet.
So there you have a view of kind of the future, and especially the role of carbon and in our global system, and how important it is to manage CO2 emissions in particular. Now, the state of California has begun a kind of first stab at regulating carbon through cap and trade, kind of an auction, right? And that seems to have gone off pretty well for the first time, although there's now some court action pending. We also know that international conferences like the climate conference at Doha, which just ended yesterday, has failed to really set targets for global emissions. And this is largely the result of conflicts between some of the developed countries in the world who are afraid of losing, you know, kind of their momentum in terms of development, and also the developing countries like China that are moving into the developed world and are demanding the right to burn more carbon in order to generate more wealth. And so there's a kind of complicated ballet going on in the kind of global arena between the developed countries and the less developed countries, and where they're going to go into the future. And the United States has not taken a leadership role in this, and we've since retreated. And of course, according to Al Jazeera television here, and I can bring up this article, but they have also looked at how the Russians have come in at the last minute at Doha and objected to the agreement that was just reached. So I'm not sure what the impact of that will be, but nearly 200 nations agreed to extend the protocol limiting greenhouse gas emissions until 2020. So we have, you know, a little bit of time left in order to deal with this, you know, another 7-8 years to kind of come to a more, you know, formal agreement. But our problem is that the sooner we start curtailing the emissions, the better it will be, because they will have less time to accumulate in the global system. So this is a question for us. How are we going to handle this into the future? And we also have the strategy of reducing emissions, and I'm going to show you this other bookmark from Canada here. Oil sands, as I mentioned earlier, and will raise emissions, the Canadian report. So the Canadian government has fought attempts by other governments to characterize oil sands as dirty oil, and yet their own analysis shows that it will increase or triple oil, or rather greenhouse gas emissions, to 92 million metric tons by 2020 from a base level of 30 million metric tons today. So this is, and most of it comes to the United States. And this is probably one of the dirtiest and most polluting types of operations ever. And the destruction that it does, not only to the Arctic environment and the tundra and the northern boreal forest up there, the taiga, also unprecedented. This is really also water pollution. I mean, they use the steam to extract it from the sand. I mean, it's just water to generate steam to extract it from the sand. So there's all kinds of problems with this on a global scale. So I want to show you this next video that just deals with reducing emissions, some of the strategies we can adopt to deal with this problem. But one of the most important things we can do, of course, is to drive less, drive hybrid, or use less fuel on a daily, monthly basis. And we can all do these things. And watch your utilities, watch those things too, because in general, in Los Angeles, for example, most of our energy, electrical energy, comes from the burning of coal and coal plants in other states. And so we owe them a favor too, right? You know, we don't want to just give them the bad stuff and we get the good. So let's watch this little video. I'll give a cut when we're done.
How do we know humans are causing greenhouse gas concentrations to increase? Determining the human influence of greenhouse gas concentrations was challenging because many greenhouse gases occur naturally in Earth's atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is produced and consumed in many natural processes that are part of the carbon cycle. Once humans began digging up long-buried forms of carbon, such as coal and oil, and burning them for energy, additional CO2 was released into the atmosphere, much more rapidly than in the natural carbon cycle. Other human activities, such as cement production and cutting down forests, have also added CO2 to the atmosphere. Until the 1950s, many scientists thought the oceans would absorb most of the excess CO2 released by human activities. Then, a series of scientific papers were published that examined the dynamics of carbon dioxide exchange between the ocean and atmosphere, including a paper by oceanographers Roger Revelle and Hans Suess in 1957, and another by Bert Bolin and Erik Erikson in 1959. This work led scientists to the hypothesis that the oceans could not absorb all of the CO2 being emitted. To test this hypothesis, Revelle's colleague, Charles David Keeling, began collecting air samples at the Mauna Loa Observatory in Hawaii to track changes in CO2 concentrations. Today, such measurements are made at many sites around the world. The data reveal a steady increase in atmospheric CO2. To determine how CO2 concentration varied prior to modern measurements, scientists have studied the composition of air bubbles trapped in ice cores extracted from Greenland and Antarctica. These data show that for at least 2,000 years before the Industrial Revolution, atmospheric CO2 concentration was steady, and then began to rise sharply beginning in the late 19th century. Today, atmospheric CO2 concentration exceeds 390 parts per million, around 40% higher than pre-industrial levels. And according to ice core data, higher than any point in the past 800,000 years. Human activities have increased the atmospheric concentrations of other important greenhouse gases as well. Methane, which is produced by the burning of fossil fuels, the raising of livestock, the decay of landfill wastes, the production and transport of natural gas, and other activities increased sharply throughout the industrial age, before starting to level off at about 2.5 times its pre-industrial level. Nitrous oxide has increased by roughly 15% since 1750, mainly as a result of agricultural fertilizer use, but also from fossil fuel burning and certain industrial processes. Some industrial chemicals, such as chlorofluorocarbons, used in refrigerants and spray cans, act as potent greenhouse gases and are long-lived in the atmosphere. However, the concentration of CFCs are decreasing due to the success of the 1989 Montreal Protocol, which banned their use. Because CFCs do not have natural sources, their increases can easily be attributed to human activities. In addition to direct measurements of atmospheric CO2 concentrations, there are detailed records of how much coal, oil, and natural gas is burned each year. Through science, estimates are made of how much CO2 is being absorbed, on average, by the oceans and plant life on land. These analyses show that almost half of the excess CO2...
Okay, so we know that story already. We've seen part of that, okay? And we understand that also that without our, you know, our blanket of gases that trap heat at the Earth's surface, the temperature of Earth would be around 0 degrees Fahrenheit. That's pretty cold. But with that layer of gases, the atmosphere gases, our temperature has been on average about 59 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's kind of where we like it. We don't want it to get too much warmer than that, or the effects or the repercussions will be greater. A number of people have written in, though, and so I'll deal with some of those questions now. Joel says, does climate change affect the intensity of weather events like Katrina, Sandy, and Category 5, 4 or 5 tornadoes? Yes. The consensus is starting to emerge that these events do have their origins in the kind of increasing warmth that is in the atmosphere. And again, that increasing warmth allows for more moisture, more energy, and more energy generates stronger storms in the atmosphere. So we get more unpredictable events and the extension of these events later and later into the year. I don't know if you remember the year of Katrina. We had hurricanes that extended all the way into December and January, which is way beyond the normal time period. And just this past year, 2012, as I mentioned earlier, the Philippine minister to the Doha conference pleaded that these late season events are really devastating to the people of the Philippines. And of course, it has a lot to do also with the other cycles that are taking place, planting and harvesting and things like this that really, really have an impact on humans. John writes, there is a natural plant migration that can be attributed to birds, wind, ocean currents, but is this balance being altered due to global warming? Yes, and I mentioned the trees in Vermont and not being able to produce enough sugar, but there are also more red sugar maples, I should say, moving across into Canada to the north, and they just survive better. They like it there now that the temperatures are a little bit milder. There are those. There's the influence of hummingbirds. Hummingbirds are now showing up at different locations a little bit earlier. They actually migrate over tremendous ranges, and some of that has a lot to do with climate change. And we're studying those kind of migration patterns in order to understand the total effect. So yes, there's some evidence that suggests that global warming is actually playing a role here, and kind of forcing things earlier on and into the year too, has an impact on when species leave and when they arrive. Charles notes that the California group that conducted the auction on cap and trade is being sued because they apparently don't have jurisdiction to do that, and that is again a kind of legal question that'll have to be settled in court. But thanks for bringing that up. That is an important point. And Margaret wants to know, do you ever have geological field trips? Yes, I do, but mine are geographical in nature, although we do look at the geology as well, and it is fun to do those kinds of trips with students because you get to show them the kinds of things that you would see or learn in a class out in the real world. And Southern California has a lot of those locations, from landslides to slump and, the Palos Verdes Peninsula, and you can, there's a lot of places to go. And then of course there's the desert, and you can see the cinder cones out there, and those are all fun. Anyway, we can't do it on a TV class because it wouldn't be the same, although maybe we could just photograph it, huh? We only have a few minutes left, so I have a few words to say in conclusion for the course. Some last words. One of the important movers in this discussion of global climate change has been Jim Hansen of the NASA Goddard Institute for Space Studies. And he's always been out there in front saying that humans need to address the accumulation of CO2 in the atmosphere. He really sees this as an important component of global warming and an important component of changes in the global environment. And he was, in fact, one of those arrested in front of the White House a year ago or so, protesting the construction of the Keystone Pipeline, which would send tar sand oil down through the U.S. over the Ogallala Aquifer on its way to refineries along the Gulf Coast or in Oklahoma. There are also plenty of images that show the increase in global temperature. These are mostly done by satellite now, and they're pretty impressive when you kind of look at them carefully. They really do give a lot of information, and we are now evaluating the planet in many, many ways and observing what's taking place there. This is a view of, you know, Earth from the moon, and one of the places that you have to get to in order to see the whole world. It is one of the images that has also kind of inspired a lot of people to become environmentalists, because we realize that we live on this rather small planet, this little blue marble in space, and that this is the only really habitable place that we have, the one that's best suited to us on our species, and of course to all the other species that co-evolved with us on this planet. And, you know, we have to also recognize that the Earth environment has changed repeatedly in the past, and that we have adapted. Now, human beings haven't been around as long as everyone else, and all these other organisms that are still around have somehow managed to pull through. Will we be the species that does survive more change into the future? Also, Lawrence Smith, who's a professor of geography at UCLA, has had extensive experience up in the Arctic, and he's been instrumental in putting together some new views of what the world of the future will look like. And one of the things he talks about is the new north, and how a lot of things will start moving northward as the climate warms and changes up in the Arctic. And there'll be competition for resources and all kinds of things as we kind of move in that direction, as we move farther northward. And of course, we have three different views of what happens with population. We've got the high fertility model here that kind of says, well, you know, we're gonna be up around 11 or 12 billion people by the year 2100. That's a lot of people to take care of on an Earth that we're already finding, you know, is feeling the stress and strain. There's the more, you know, moderate view here that puts it down around, you know, 9 billion, but we're already at 7, so I'm not sure that we're going to be able to hold to that. And then this is a really optimistic one that says, well, we're going to kind of get it back down to about 6 billion or so, and ship has sailed, is that Dr. Phil? Yeah, that train has left the station, all that. So here's some of the northern rim that Dr. Smith is looking at, and some of the changes up there in terms of resource acquisition, the new exploitation of the Arctic regions, and all that kind of thing. 1 minute to go? Really? I thought we were leaving at 1:40. Close. I was panicked there. Anyway, what can you do as an individual? Well, buy products that consume less energy, garden, grow your own food, eat locally. You can use energy wisely. That's always a good idea. Weatherize, insulate. And of course, you know, stay away from hazardous things. The U.S. deaths from natural hazards by category from 1970 to 2004 are shown here. And, you know, some of these are going to change as a result of climate change. They will. Winter weather may be, you know, here 18.1%. They may get worse. You know, winters may get worse. I know it doesn't seem like in global warming that would be a problem. But here's another one: heat and drought. That's something we always have to watch for. More stormy conditions may mean more lightning, so you have to know when to get out of the outdoors and get to safety. Severe weather of all kinds, you know, tornadoes, hurricanes, other kinds of storms. Here's tornadoes by itself, just 11.6%. Flooding over here. Mass movement, still relatively small, because we usually know when they're about to happen and we can warn people, but not always, as we saw. And, you know, then we have coastal processes and geophysical events, you know, earthquakes. You see? Those are all the things that are kind of pointing at us. Beware, be cautious, be aware of what's going on. Actively recycle, close the loop, get things, you know, back into circulation, reuse things. You know, give to others, you know, your extra stuff. Move closer to work if you can, use alternate transport, unplug and disconnect your vampires, you know, the things that are on all the time. I know it's a hassle to go over and turn on the TV by hand, but you know, it does save electricity over the long run. And some of these new flat screen things just soak up electricity all the time, and they're really, really vampires. And of course, become involved in what's going on around you, and especially in terms of the environment. Get educated, find an issue that you believe in, support them financially, support them with your presence, you know, be there for them, go to their events, write letters to your congressman, for example. And industry and government can do some things too. They can promote more photovoltaics, they can mandate this in some cases, they can mandate energy cost savings through code enforcement, and they can do this easily, and they already are. Title 24, for example, in California is setting new standards that are being followed everywhere in terms of, you know, switching for lighting and the types of lighting that are available. Eliminate subsidies to the fossil fuel industry and start, you know, subsidizing those industries that we want to see long term. This is also important. Promote carbon capture and sequestration. You know, let's get some of that carbon back into the ground, store it somewhere. Plant more trees, which is another way to sequester carbon, and it gives us a way of holding carbon dioxide. And you know, if you look at this, this is our view of the processes involved in the atmosphere. It's very complicated. It's a big, complicated system. So it's difficult for us to do really accurate climate models, but we're getting better at it every day. More and more people are working on these things, and we're trying to understand the nature of how the world works. And this, in fact, is a growing area of concern and involvement. And there are many careers to be made here in understanding how the world works. With new data, unprecedented levels of data from satellites and observation stations all around the world, interconnected now by, you know, the internet. It's very cool. So we can all get educated, we can all know the issues, teach others, and practice, of course, as much as we can what we preach. Limit consumption, because we need to use the materials that we have wisely. Wear things out. You know, don't be so eager to take advantage of a sale on a shirt that's made in Honduras or somewhere else. Increase the habitat around you. Participate in protecting parks and wilderness areas. Feed people, because they are our greatest resource. They deserve to eat. Make sure they're sheltered and clothed as well. And love the world, because it's our home. It's the place where we live and where our generations before us have lived, and where we hope generations to come will continue to survive, if we're sustainable in the kinds of things that we choose to do for our lives and our living. So perhaps, Theodore Jericholt's most significant and certainly most ambitious work, The Raft of Medusa, and I think we have a picture of it here, depicts the aftermath of a contemporary French shipwreck, the Meduse, in which the captain had left the crew and passengers to die and stranded them. And perhaps this image is a fitting metaphor for the current state of the Earth. Garrett Hardin, the environmental writer, wrote about lifeboat ethics as the way in which we as a society should evaluate our options in a world of expanding population and resource depletion. Allow too many people on board the life raft and we all drown. And the future of those on the life raft remains in doubt. After all, there are only limited energy emergency supplies on lifeboats and nothing to sustain us for the long term. So there's this vision that is not particularly nice about the future of humanity, clinging to this really small blue marble in space, and we really need to think about ways to prevent this. You know, we need to begin to think about how do we construct a world that's sustainable. And so perhaps we need a more benign or slightly more optimistic perspective in which we, the people of the Earth, commit ourselves to the preservation of our planet, its people, and the resources that we use and find vital. Surely it is not true, as the bumper sticker asserts, that he who dies with the most toys wins. However, it is most certainly true that no one takes it with them in the end. And so we need a world that is based on sustainable principles, not on how much we can consume in a lifetime. A world in which we have all adopted what Aldo Leopold, who was just up on the screen there a second ago, called a land ethic, treating the world, land, water, forests, prairies, and wildlife with respect, and with an eye towards protecting the natural environment as a home for the for human beings and for the, those we share the earth with, all species. In his lifetime, Aldo Leopold really thought about the impact of humanity on particular pieces of the earth and observed the natural world around him and made note of the changes that were taking place even back then. So we've arrived at the end of our class in the last 5 minutes here. So I hope, however, that is not the end of your interest in the earth and, of course, all these exciting and hazardous and complex things that are going on around us, all these dynamic systems that are kind of suddenly maybe you're more aware of. I hope that this class has opened your eyes to new perspectives and your mind to new understandings about, well, your role in the world and some of the challenges that we will face going into the next decades. We live on a planet that is changing, and human society must change in response. Like the sandhill crane that Aldo Leopold, you know, observed from his small cabin out in the Wisconsin woods, or the monarch butterfly I mentioned before, who make their annual migrations over generations, which is also astounding. You know, one generation makes it, you know, halfway, and then the next generation carries on, and they finally make it to the cornfields, and then they make their way back. How do they know how to do that? How does that get passed on? There's no books. They encode it in their DNA. I don't know. It's amazing. These are the amazing things that are around us in our world that we just take for granted. We don't take the time to appreciate. And maybe if we did, we'd think more, well, more sustainably, more carefully about what we do in the world. To accommodate, to feed billions, to provide water, resources, and habitat for both humans and the other species we share the planet with, and to do so with an eye to the future and towards sustainability. That's the most important mission that we have. So at the beginning of the course, we did allow ourselves a little bit to talk about our ecological footprint. Hopefully we've all been able to reduce that somewhat. And I do want to thank you for being with me all along the way as we've gone through lots of disasters together. And I want to thank the Applied Studies Program and, of course, all my students here, and there are many, and I'm very pleased that you've stayed with me as well through the class, to Warren Ashley and Van Bridgman, kind of the producers, to the crew of students that are working behind the scenes here to make it all happen and get the images up on time and get the right video in the right time frame and to deal with all the kind of changes that do occur behind the scenes. They've done a great job, and they really deserve some recognition. So I give it to them here, and I hope that when you have an opportunity to run across them, and you'll see their names at the end when the credits roll, to tell them what a nice job they did. And of course, also, thanks for all of your hard work. I do hope that you have, you know, we'll post the final exam tomorrow by 5 o'clock, and it'll have all the instructions that you need to do there. And there will be about 25 questions, kind of objective style, and there'll be two short essays to do, and then you'll be done, okay? Any last minute things have to be done by Saturday, next Saturday at 11:59 p.m. So, all that being said, thanks again, and I do really, truly appreciate the opportunity to be here as your instructor and to have taken you somewhere along the way towards understanding about our natural environment and the natural hazards that are all around us. So, all that being said, have a good holiday season and enjoy the coming days off, and we'll see you back here sometime. Okay?
You are watching DHTV. the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
He's going to have to end.
Hi Taurus, my name is Geneva Miriam Koulibaly. I am the ASI president and also a senior of the year 2013. So I'm here to talk to you about the iGuess campaign, which is a challenge for us to raise enough money to be able to donate iPads to the library for the iPad loan program. So how to give? You can pick up one of those postcards in the Associated Students office, in the library, and also in the Office of Alumni Programs. Make sure that you fill out the bag and return it to the Office of Alumni Programs. You can also visit the website online for the Senior Gift Class campaign. If you're gonna pay right now, it's totally fine. You have the option to make a pledge by giving your information, your name, and your email to the Office of Alumni Programs, and from then you have 90 days to be able to pay your $20.32. And don't forget, you get the possibility to own that beautiful t-shirt with the year 2013 in the back. Very important for you to know, whatever amount of money that we're able to raise, our alumni will support us and match every cent. So don't forget, we want to leave our legacy, we want to be remembered, and once a Toro, always a Toro.
November 1st through November 28th, El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, Day of the Dead altars, and the student showcase in studio art. Mexico celebrates a rich tradition of arte popular that reaches more than 2,000 years into the Mesoamerican past. El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, celebrates this enduring tradition through a variety of ceramics, metalwork, paper art, sculpture, and other works of art. A special Day of the Dead altar installation by Dr. Miguel Dominguez, professor of modern languages, will also be on display, as well as a Day of the Dead altar by the prominent Los Angeles artist Edith Abeita and CSUDH alumna artist Victoria Almeida.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.